Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of How to Do Drugs. I am your host, Alia Janine. I have a very special guest all the way from the West Coast, Miss Amy Dresner, or is it Mrs.? Oh. I don't know. Are you married or not married?
No, I'm divorced.
No. Yes, single and mingling. Or maybe not. I don't know.
Not really during the pandemic. It's sort of me and my cat. Yeah.
Yeah, I have my dog, and that's and that's fine for me. I kind of like it, just me and my dog. Even before the pandemic, I was like, I think it's just gonna be me and you, bitch. I think this is. I think you're the one. We don't have to do anything sexual because that's really weird and that's illegal in most states. So, yes.
But also, in Bali, you could go marry your cat. I googled it, which just shows you how badly my love life's going. No, I also just took a break. I was like, after my last breakup with the ex-boyfriend just shattered me, and so I was just like, mm-hmm. You know what, I'm gonna take a break to just like heal and also like look at the patterns that are fucking me up and why I'm picking assholes. So
yeah, why
I've been
do
in, like,
I
keep romantic coaching. I've been taking this time to look inward and like really work on myself, my childhood trauma. I know I'm so LA, right? You're like, ew.
Oh no, I lived in LA for 4 years.
So you know.
Yeah, I have two juicers. I moved to New York with two
crystals.
Juicers.
Do you have crystals?
Well, yeah. But I mean, okay. I grew up
with crystals. Do you have a dream catcher?
Yeah. Well, I'm Native American. So I have some of that stuff, but yeah, the crystals, that thing is kind of new. And that was a pandemic thing for me. I'm like, I'm going to be pagan. I'm like, let me get some spices and some salts and some. Oh yeah,
I
no. I'm like, you could become a witch on Amazon for like $200.
I'm fucking in.
But I have noticed because I also started meditating, so I'm like, I'm super zen as fuck. It's like I still want to stab people, but like the rage to stab them is now gone. And I think that
do you know that I tried to do that? That's what I was arrested for.
Meditating or stabbing somebody.
Was obviously not meditating enough. I haven't stabbed anyone since, and I'm like, you know, I'm good at meditating and then I fall off, like with exercise. Like I'm really in writing, like with everything. Mm-hmm. I'm like really like I'm on it for a couple of days, and then like, you know, like if I miss a day or whatever, then I just
fall off, then it's ruined.
Like, yeah, and then it's like yeah, and then it's just I never do it again. It's just like ugh.
For me, it's always the time thing. Like if I wake up even like 15 minutes late, I'm like, I don't have time to work out. I literally have nothing to fucking do. I can work out at 3 o'clock in the morning if I want to, but that is not the right time to work out. I need to work out during these times. Otherwise, it's just never going to work out. So that kind of like mentality, I'm like, nope, we can't do it. And I'm 5 minutes late. It's also just like a good way to, make excuses as to why.
Oh yeah. I'm a queen.
I don't do a lot of stuff. I found out that like recently too, that like I have ADHD and a lot of that has to do with ADHD, like all these random little projects that I have going on and stuff like that. Like I've been meditating now for 65 days and
good
I was
girl.
Like, I'm like, I'm an expert. but it also like, cause the app tells you. And so it's kind of like that goal thing where it's just like, I could do another day. And so now it's like, now it's actually part of like my
That's
routine,
awesome.
But they always say that's like, what is it? Like 20 or 21 days to like, make
I've heard
something.
That's bullshit, but I don't know.
Yeah, no, it is because I've tried it and I'm like, for me, I think it's about 60 days. I think I need a couple of months.
Like I'm, you know, I'm a recovering drug addict. So it's like, we're like all or nothing. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. We're vegan and doing CrossFit or we're like smoking meth and fucking randos on Tinder. Like we're not, you know what I mean? We're just like the middle ground, you know, we're either doing it or we're not doing it. That's it.
Doing it.
For
2 years. Yeah. So I want to go back to the stabbing because stabbing one is a very personal thing. And I carry knives all the time. Like living in New York and LA.
I don't think I'm allowed to.
No, probably not. I'm going to say no to the
I'm not a violent person, but I don't. That's why I'm sober because I'm really an asshole when I drink and do drugs. I become somebody else.
Yeah, someone.
Ooh, like, and I enjoy that person.
Yeah.
Because I'm going, fuck what you think or whatever. But everyone else is like, wow, you bug out.
Yeah. I definitely have gotten that. We never stabbed. I mean, I've definitely gotten into like fist fights with dudes before. I've always fought dudes, never women. Thank God for that. Like maybe one or two in high school. But yeah, so tell me about that journey and like what got you to the point where you felt that you needed to stab somebody.
God. Well, do you want to just follow your thing? Cause it's like that will fall in. I mean, I was in a marriage and
you were married. Okay. So you're married.
And, you know, it was a terrible marriage and you know, I was high on Oxycontin for a shoulder surgery that I, you know, and I was abusing it, and I was mm-hmm. drinking like Four Loko or something that I think is illegal now. It's so gross. I know. It was amazing. It got you where you needed to be. I wasn't like champagne and I was like, how do I get to where I need to be
the fastest?
Yeah. That's why.
And the cheapest, normally the cheapest. Yeah, too.
That's why I got into IV drug use too. I was like, if you had to take a rickshaw, would you take a Uruguay? I fucked that up. You have to edit that. I said, if you had to go to Uruguay, would you take a rickshaw or a rocket? Like, let's get to where the fuck we're going. I don't have time. Like, yeah. I want to be high. So how do we get to being high?
Yeah, as fast as possible.
I didn't start that way.
No. When was the first time you started using, like, heavily? Like, how old were you?
24.
So you were fairly young.
Yeah,
Crystal meth. Was that just like a situational kind of thing, or just like, oh, hey, try it?
And it was that answers everything you need to know, right? I was in San Francisco, and it was like someone offered it to me, and I was like, oh, I didn't even know what it was. I was like, mm-hmm. okay, cool. I mean, I'd been really sort of a good girl up till that point.
Yeah. Did you try anything else like before that, like mushrooms?
Yeah, I did Molly, mm-hmm. and you know, I think I did mushrooms during the crystal meth period, but you know. Crystal meth, the first time I didn't like it, I was like, ooh, this is like being plugged into a fucking wall socket or something. I was like, this is gnarly. I don't like it. Mm-hmm. And the second time I did it, I fucking loved it. I felt like I was home, and I felt like, oh God, this is way, I need this. This is my medication. This is how I need to feel all the time.
Yeah. How long did you use? How long did you use meth?
2.5 years.
Yeah. What made
give me full blown epilepsy now? Yay!
That actually gave you epilepsy mm-hmm. for? Oh wow! I guess like doing some
it
drugs.
It fries your brain, man. Fries your brain. So now I have hyperactive lesions on my frontal lobe. But
oh wow! Did you used to like smoke it or snort it? Because like there have been times both. Yeah.
Ate it. I heard you could like put it in a piece of paper or bread and eat it. I did all that shit. I never shot crystal meth. I shot coke, but I didn't shoot crystal meth.
Yeah, I've never anything intravenously. With all the tattoos I have, I'm still kind of afraid of needles.
It's a whole other world, man.
Yeah.
It's really dark really fast. I mean, once you cross that line, there's really no coming back from that.
Yeah, that's definitely
you get addicted to sort of the ritual of it, I think. Mm-hmm. That's a big part of it.
Yeah, like even with cocaine, like chopping it up and then lining it up, like getting the little mirror or like even going to the bathroom. Same with cigarettes, just like after
I quit vaping during the pandemic. I miss it so much.
Oh, wow. That's tough. Smoking too. Quit everything.
I got nothing. I got nothing.
Smoking has always been like my thing. I thought like I hated it growing up, like with my dad and my stepmother smoked. And just the smell, you know, it was the 80s and 90s where you could still smoke in cars where it was legal with your kids, you know what I mean? With the windows rolled up and just be like, you're gonna kill me. And then, after the first couple, I'm like, oh no, I'm a smoker. Cause like, it's like my mom doesn't smoke and her sister doesn't smoke, but everyone on my dad's side smokes and like randomly on my mom's side. So it's just like, statistically, I was going to end up a smoker. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I'm genetically. Just that too. I was smoking and vaping and then I would switch off between the two. But I didn't start that until like my 30s. I was sort of a late bloomer with everything. Then I really fucking blew out hard. I mean, like, I have a pretty low bottom in terms of my story, which is weird, you know, starting so late. I was like, I'm going to make up for time. Don't worry.
Yeah. Be like, oh, well, I didn't experiment in my 20s teens. Give me all the stuff right now. I have to make up. That's actually kind of funny. So what made you quit doing meth? You said you were, like, pretty heavy into that.
It got really weird and out of control. Meth is gnarly. I mean, meth mm-hmm. is pretty intense shit. And this was in the 90s. I don't know what it's like now, but, I was doing all the stuff that tweakers do, like staying mm-hmm. up for 17 days and writing a new Bible. I had the mathematical equation for God and like plucking my eyebrows for 7 hours straight. And I was writing a new book, which I mm-hmm. still have somewhere and I just won't even look at it. I'm so freaked out to even look at it.
Right.
I walked into a market and I woke up on a gurney in an ambulance and I had a seizure.
Was that the first one you had?
And then I didn't have them again till for like I was like 5 years clean again, and then I was living in Paris and I started having them like every fucking week.
Oh, wow.
Weird. Yeah. But so that got me into my first of seven rehabs. That
was, first of like, seven right, yeah. rehabs. So how is rehab? I know my father has been in it. We had one other guest on the show who was in it, but is it like, there's a difference between like a psych ward and
I've been in both. Yeah.
You've been in both.
What do you want to know?
So how do those, like, how are those comparable and how, like, which one is better or like more helpful, I guess I should say, especially like depending on like, I guess it depends on how much money are you know, you have to spend on the type of care too.
I've been in rehab about seven times and, I've been in some high-end rehabs mm-hmm. and, definitely prefer rehab to the psych ward. I mean, rehab is great if you need somewhere to sort of detox, be stabilized, be in a contained environment to stop using. Cause some mm-hmm. people sometimes, and that's for me, I can't stop using on my own. I have to be put somewhere to stop using. And then I can kind of like slowly get my brain back. But like, did it keep me sober in the long term? Not usually. Mm-hmm. Obviously, if I've been there seven times.
Seven times.
I think the treatment industry has become, I don't think you can, I think that addiction is like it's a lifelong thing that you have to deal with. And I don't think you're going to cure it in 30, 60 or 90 fucking days. And
yeah.
I think that the problem is the treatment industry has become really like about money. It's become really greedy with insurance fraud and body brokering and throwing mm-hmm. everyone in the same groups, despite whatever their trauma is or level, you know, sorry, there's someone honking, you know, like despite your drug, you know, despite your level of addiction, I really believe there's a spectrum of addiction. There are people mm-hmm. who are like over here and there are people that are like all the way over here. You know, mm-hmm. I know people who like shot dope and now can like smoke pot and drink casually and people in AA flip out when I say that, but it's like, I do know people like that. Mm-hmm. And then I know me who can't do fucking anything.
Yeah.
Ever.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I've done an experiment 900 times with every single fucking thing there is from mm-hmm. dick to fucking like, you know what I mean? It doesn't even matter. To yerba mate, to the jewel, to mm-hmm. shopping. I'm like, oh God, really? You know?
Yeah, if you're doing one thing, it's going to help.
Yeah, I mean, you can leave rehab against your will.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you're a grown person.
When you're a grown up, you could do whatever you want.
Yeah, I mean, you know, your parents might be like, I'm going to cut you off or fuck you and you better stay there or whatever, or you might not have somewhere to go or whatever. But with a psych ward, if you check yourself in, you're fucked.
Yeah.
You're on a 5150, you're on a 3-day hold against your will. You can't leave.
Yeah, it's like 72 hours or whatever.
Yeah, if you're a harm to yourself or others. So I've been in the psych ward four times. Once I think I checked myself in and said, I can't stop drinking, I'm gonna kill myself. Mm-hmm. And the other three were completely against my will.
Will.
And psych wards are depressing. I mean, it's the worst place to put someone depressed because it's like mm-hmm. really fucking depressing. It's really, really mentally ill people, like people who think they're Thomas Jefferson and mm-hmm. like really, really ill people,
mm-hmm.
horrible food, no windows. You know what I mean? You're like mm-hmm. in a gown. You're just like, you know, you're
very vulnerable. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's just like, it's so.
Is it almost like dehumanizing, especially like because they make you wear like the same outfits and stuff like that?
Well,
like,
when you're in a green gown, everything you fucking say sounds crazy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It doesn't really matter. You know, I was like, well, I'm afraid that my cat's not eating. Mm-hmm. Like, did he tell you that? I'm like, no, I fuck it, but I don't have someone taking care of him. You know, so it was like, one time I was in blackout on Ativan mm-hmm. and I checked myself into the psych ward thinking that it was a spa. My dad was like, you need to go somewhere and cool out. I was like, do you mean like a spa?
I love spas.
I know. Well, me too. I'm a Jack. And I was like, you mean like a spa? And he was like, kind of. And so I checked myself in a Cedars-Sinai Thalian psych ward that doesn't exist anymore, thinking it was spa. So of course the next day I'm like, I'm wearing my bathing suit. I thought this was a spa. And they're like, okay.
Oh God.
Yeah. So I look even more crazy.
And that's gotta be terrifying too, where like, cause
it
you're
is
in-
terrifying and you can't leave. It's really depressing. Yeah.
You're like, no, I'm sane. I'm sane.
No, they don't believe you. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh yeah. God. Yeah. That's probably
some really, really, really ill people. I mean, there are different levels, but it's very, very, very depressing.
Yeah, I don't see them like helping.
It doesn't help. I don't think it helps. I think that people, during one of my stays, there was a girl who was bipolar who was there to just, you know, protect herself while she changed meds.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Yeah. The changing of the meds is always,
you know what I mean? Yeah. That's always like a weird time. But like, yeah. But most people were pretty psychotic.
And yeah, like actually like
suicidal. it was pretty gnarly and it was sad, and it's like you don't really see any treatment, you know?
Yeah,
you know, it's
they're basically just there so they're not bugging like other people.
Yeah, it's just like, so they're not harming themselves or you know, trying to stab someone, which I did later. Like, you know, it's like, you know, we're just like in arts and crafts and grooming group and whatever, and so I was, you know, you can read it in my book. I was such a dick. So I was like, you know, I didn't think I belonged there. And maybe I did, maybe I didn't. But I was like, I was really, really a smart ass.
Yeah.
There longer. The guy was just like, you think you're too smart to be here. And it was like, oh, fuck, you know.
Well, yeah.
Got to play the game to get out.
Yeah.
You know, my dad was like, if you want to get out of there, Ames, you got to act like someone who can get out of there. And I was like, oh, Jesus Christ.
So, you got to play that role, which that is also just humiliating too, I'm sure.
It's totally humiliating. It's
and then they like, for some reason, I feel that like some of those types of professionals like kind of get off on that as well, that
And they fuck with your meds, and like they fucked with my seizure meds, and I got out and I had like a huge grand mal seizure and cracked my head open. I was like, great job, motherfuckers, like,
yeah,
you know. And it's just, it's I remember seeing a cute boy there, and I was like, oh, who's that? And I was like, oh, that's the place to meet your next boyfriend, really, is the psych ward. Good idea.
Well, at least you already know all the red flags.
Yeah,
you know?
I was like, no. Yeah, I haven't been in a psych ward in this sobriety at all. Thank God, Jesus.
Well, that's good. How long have you been sober?
This time, I had 8 years in January 2nd.
Nice. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah. No, that's a big fucking deal.
Yeah.
Do you have like a lot of like, what are some of your triggers, if you want to talk about those? Mental or more like situational? You know what I mean? Where it's like, maybe you're like out somewhere.
When I feel trapped like in my, yeah. Okay. Well, I live in West Hollywood, which is a very gay area. And before the pandemic, after Pride, I was walking up the street and to Starbucks, and I found a huge bag of crystal meth. And I hadn't seen crystal in like 20 years.
Yeah.
And I literally like stopped in my tracks. And I was like, keep walking, bitch. Like, what are you doing? And I kept walking back to it. And then I kicked it. And then I picked it up. And then there was a hole in the bag. And some of it got on my finger. My head's like, lick it. Smell it. And I was like, oh my God. I was literally like frozen. It was so weird. Mm-hmm. I hadn't seen my drug of choice in 20 something years, you know? And so I called someone sober, and I was like, I'm fucking freaking out. I have a enormous bag. Like, it looks like glass, like really good crystal.
Right. That you just found.
That I just found on my street after Pride, and my sober neighbors aren't home, and I'm not in the best place. And like, my head's telling me to take it home and fucking do it.
Yeah.
And he FaceTimed me and we flushed it. But that was a big trigger, just seeing the drug like that in person. Syringes for me, because I shot coke for, I guess, 2 years. Syringes, yeah. Watching people shoot up in movies, woo!
Yeah, I can't do it.
Like, my heart just starts racing, and I feel like I'm gonna throw up, but I feel excited at the same time. Mm-hmm. And it's like, you know, they're starting to really get graphic. Like, you know, I had to stop watching Intervention because it was giving me using dreams. I was like, ooh.
Yeah.
Just even seeing syringes on the street when I got arrested and I was on a street sweeping crew, I would see syringes.
Like,
and I was like, oh yeah, syringes, you know. Even getting my blood drawn still triggers me, or when I'm working out. Yeah, seeing all my veins, like big veins, I'm like, oh man, that would be a good one. And I'm like, oh, okay.
It's all healed now and shit. Yeah. I remember my dad's arm is totally like destroyed. I mean, he was in Vietnam and just medical work, but like his arm is just destroyed.
Well, I shot coke, so my arms are fine, incredibly.
Yeah.
I don't have any track marks or anything. Emotionally, it's like heartbreak's a big one.
Mm-hmm.
That's a huge one. My dad got cancer last year, and my first thought was like, I gotta get fucking high. I cannot, yeah. I cannot do this. The longer I stay sober, it's like, I mean, I've been sober and not sober for over 25 years. I've had like years of sobriety and then relapse. And so it's always been horrible. Mm-hmm. Like it got worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. Mm-hmm. And so I know that it's not going to fix it. So then my head just goes to just like kill yourself. Like, and yeah. You can't deal with the feeling. It's like, don't get high. Just fucking take a cab, you know, which is like scary, but true. And that's mm-hmm. very common for people in the program because they know where using is going to take them. It's not going to be anywhere good. So they're just like, I'm out, man.
And some people will just use until they kill themselves because of the...
Yeah, it's a slow suicide. I mean, when you're shooting mm-hmm. coke in your neck, like I was with epilepsy and having mm-hmm. seizures, and I would have a seizure shooting coke, and instead of going like, you know, you really shouldn't shoot coke when you have epilepsy, I was like, well, shooting coke is, you know, obviously a very high impact sport, and I should wear protective gear. That seems clear. And so I shot coke wearing a bike helmet.
A helmet?
Yeah.
Yeah. And you justified it that way.
That made total sense to me at the time. Mm-hmm. I still think it's kind of genius. I mean, it's a ridiculous.
Yeah. Yeah. If you have epilepsy and you like to do drugs, fucking wear a helmet. We used to get a lot of like nitrous tanks and he would fish out. We called it fishing out when he would do too much. We put a fucking helmet on him.
Fish out. Oh my God.
From too much nitrous. Yeah. Is that what you call the two fishing out?
No, I never heard that, but it's really funny because you flop around like a fish. It's really funny.
Yeah. And he's just a big dude and he hit his head really hard on a table.
Yeah. Line. That's the part. Status epilepticus, which is like where you just seize and seize and seize and seize mm-hmm. and seize, and that will kill you. The other part that will really kill you is like opening up your head on something. I've done.
So yeah, so the helmet.
Or broken teeth. I've like fallen, you know, I live by myself. You don't want to have one when you're driving. And I don't really mm-hmm. have auras, so I don't feel them coming.
Mm-hmm. So that's, and now that you're sober, do you still, do you get them?
I'm on so much goddamn medication. It's a miracle I'm awake.
Yeah. Do you think like taking meds and stuff like that for your epilepsy actually like may help with the drug thing? Cause it like, you're maybe tricking your brain that you're doing drugs. I mean, technically you are. You're like, no, bitch.
No. I mean, people can go, oh, you're not sober because you're on scheduled, you know, controlled medication. And I can be like, you know, I have a medical condition. Like, I don't want to be on, I don't even like downers, man.
I never liked downers.
I mean, I think that weird fundamentalism is bullshit. So, no, I was never really a big pill popper. I like snorting stuff. I like shooting stuff. I liked drinking, but drinking didn't like me. That was like drinking really made me like sort of violent and rapey. Yeah, it was like immediate, and I black out like immediately. It was horrible.
Oh wow! So you didn't really drink a lot then, or you?
I tried not to.
Was the thing that was too much. You'd be like, all right, I could shoot this coke, but I'm definitely not.
I mean, shooting coke, I was like at least sort of coherent in my fucking right mind. I mean, like. Drinking, I don't even know what the fuck. I would black out. I was messy. I would make a bazillion call. I would do all kinds of crazy shit. Same with Ativan. Ativan, I blacked out. I was in a blackout for 3 weeks. Going to AA meetings, kicking over chairs and being like, I'm a princess, motherfuckers. Like, just like, it's really, like, really bad. But yeah, drinking was, woo.
At least that's something that you knew to be like, all right, we're not going to do this. Well, maybe because that's also like more of a social thing too, you know, where you're
I never was a social drinker or user. I was someone who partied alone. It was self-medication and it was addiction to, you know, I didn't want to be judged. I didn't want anyone to be like, God, you're doing a lot of, you're doing a lot of drugs. Like I was like, it was never fun. It was what I needed to stay on the planet. It was addiction. It was never a social thing ever.
Yeah. Some people it is definitely a social thing, and some people because I've definitely, like I've talked about before, where like even during the pandemic, like drinking at home alone has never been a thing that I did because I'm like, oh, that means I have a problem. But now I'm like, there's no place else to drink, and I got my, like, I woke up in my bathroom and I'm just like, what the fuck, and I don't really drink that much now, But I'm like, I got myself that drunk and just like,
right. No, there's been a lot of, you know, day drinking has become a big thing during the pandemic. And yeah, it'll be interesting to see how that shakes out, whether people develop a problem or not. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah. There's definitely, I remember in the beginning, well, probably, I want to say maybe more like towards like June, like around now last year, there was a couple of videos. There was one video in particular where a dude was jogging down his block and he was looking through all the recyclables of all his neighbors and just bottles of booze, beer, like everyone is just wasted, just drinking. Yeah, drinking went up so much.
And it's like, so did overdoses. Overdoses mm-hmm. went up, suicide went up. I mean, mm-hmm. people really lost their shit. It's a really yeah. hard time to be in recovery because,
yeah,
you know, to be that lonely and isolated, you know, with that much financial shit going on was just like, It was a tough time to stay sober, and we lost like a lot of people.
Yeah,
it was just a struggle, for sure. I quit vaping during the pandemic, which was incredible.
Yeah, like I would have figured, like the vaping thing. They still have they have non nicotine vapes. Like
Why would you want that though? That's so stupid to me. Why?
Because it's again, it's like that the ritual of it. Yeah, I used those for a little while, but yeah, I just went back to
why? Like fucking no. It's like that. People were just titrate down. If I was able to titrate down, I wouldn't be vaping 4 Juul pods a day. I can't mm-hmm. titrate down. I'm titrating up.
Yeah.
What I'm doing. I can't, you know, I was fishing them out of the garbage. Like, I'm a fucking junkie, man.
Yeah. You're like, fucking Juul got me. Right?
Yeah. Like, I know. I was so pissed. I'm so like, fucking really? You can't even do the Juul in moderation? Fuck. God. It's so embarrassing.
Yeah. But some brains are just like that. Yeah. You know, it's not necessarily like, you cognitively like want to control it.
No, but I have the genetics. It's all yeah, in my family, and I've learned a lot about the science. And mm-hmm. it's like, you know,
do you have a lot of users in your family, like in the past, or yeah?
Yeah, and a lot of mental illness also. And mm-hmm. also, I've been tested for a genetic mutation called MTHFR, which is something that affects the enzyme that breaks down folic acid in green vegetables into L-methylfolate, which is the building block for dopamine and serotonin. So it's like I came into the world with not enough dopamine. So of course I'm looking for dopamine.
Yeah.
Low dopamine tone, which a lot of addicts do.
Mm-hmm.
So then you find Coke, which gives you like way too much dopamine. So
oh my God, love it. Yeah.
Right. And then you come crashing down and mm-hmm. then like it fucks up your whole brain because your brain's like, wow, this is too much dopamine. Shut those receptors down. Like, mm-hmm. you know? And the things that give you dopamine naturally are like just little things. Like they're like, oh, look at the beautiful sunset. You're like, fuck you. When you shot coke in your neck, like who cares about
it? Who cares about the fucking
yeah,
sunset?
Yeah. They're like, be of service, like help someone. You know?
Be like, I can help someone find another bag. Like that is what that's what I'm good at helping at. that's hilarious. So you've so we already talked about the rehab stuff. What else? So going back, the stabbing part, what year did that happen? I just love that. I mean, not
so,
that.
Okay, so a big mistake that people mm-hmm. with a drug problem have mm-hmm. is that they're not gonna have a problem with something that isn't their drug of choice. Like I like mm-hmm. uppers, like I like coke and meth and that kind of stuff. So I was like, I can smoke pot because like I hate pot. So now I'm smoking mm-hmm. pot every day and hating it, but just, I wanna just feel different, you know? Mm-hmm. So I had a shoulder injury and they gave me Oxycontin and I was like, it'll be fine because I don't like downers and pain pills and it'll be fine. But it was totally not fine because as soon as that veil went up between me and the world, my fucking biology kicked in, mm-hmm. my addictive biology kicked in and that fucking vacuum opened up inside me. And I was like, ah, you know, and I was like, and also the psychology part, I was in this marriage, I was unhappy. And I was mm-hmm. like, oh my God, I don't give a fuck. I don't give a fuck what you think. I don't give a fuck what I think. I don't give a fuck what he thinks. But Oxy made me really aggressive. Like,
which is,
usually it makes people chill. People are like, oh, it's so chill, man. Like, it made me scream at people. I karate chopped a realtor. And then on Christmas of 2011, I pulled a knife on my now ex-husband and was mm-hmm. arrested for felony domestic violence with a deadly weapon.
Yeah.
Went to jail.
And because of, yeah, that is definitely like, that's something that you would hear about, like someone on coke or meth or PCP, but never like an oxy.
I know, it made me really aggressive if I didn't agree with me at all.
Well, maybe because you like uppers, maybe it had like the opposite effect.
Maybe,
you
know, yeah. You know, it made me like very weird. My friend had just had a hip surgery. And so I was taking like her fucking Norcos too. And it was just yeah. like, and then I was drinking the Four Loco on top. I was just like, oh.
Yeah, so that yeah, was a deadly combination.
That's a stabbing incident.
I've just seen, because I've seen my father get stabbed and try to stab at somebody. And I'm like, because he never really talked about that situation. I'm like, I want to know what fucking drugs you were on. Got to that point.
I mean, I just kind of threatened him with a knife. I just was like, I'll gut you like a fish, you fat motherfucker. And he was just like, I'm calling the cops, you're fucking done. And so I was like, and then I locked myself in the bathroom and just did a shit ton of drugs, because I was like, well, the cops are coming, like I need to be really relaxed,
right? Which,
of course, didn't give me like much legitimacy, because I was so fucking high when they came.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
they were like reading me my Miranda rights, and I was like, I know the drill, like Law and Order is my favorite show, you guys. You know, and so it was like, and then I blacked, I was in jail, and I like a huge part of that is just blacked out,
which is because they like, I understand the arrest and stuff like that, but in a situation like that, you should be going to like a hospital.
I agree. Well, they said they'd taken me to the psych hospital before, and mm-hmm. they said, we know her. It was the same cops, and they were the sheriffs, and they were like, oh, we know her.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're not going to, you're going to jail this time.
Yeah.
I think that even the, and even in my, it was because I brandished a weapon. Before, when I'd overdosed,
mm-hmm.
I'd like tried to kill myself on my epilepsy medication, and I had taken a knife and I was going to slit my wrists. That's like more self-harm. So then they'll take you to the psych ward. But when you threaten someone else, you're.
Yeah, but it's
especially
still,
in West Hollywood.
Well, yeah, but you're also still obviously very high on drugs. And I just think that like, when it comes to situations like that, if we've seen it before, a lot of times people need more mental help or hospital type
help.
Well,
that's the problem with the justice system. Welcome
yeah,
the
huge
with
one.
Criminalizing when, drug users mm-hmm. and the whole
yeah
deal. Yeah.
Even with the weapon, for the most part, well, depending on the type of drugs, because I definitely... have heard
that wasn't
stories.
Even in, used in like my plea. My lawyer didn't even really even mention that. I was like,
that's kind of a big a big part of it.
I know, but it got dropped to a misdemeanor, and then I was given like 240 hours of community labor and a year of domestic violence counseling.
Yeah,
that's kind
were
of
you funny. The only female in that class,
you know it. Oh no, in the class, no.
No,
I was in a female domestic violence class, but it was me. It was other women who had like one girl like crashed into someone's car drunk and then like gotten out and like grabbed his glasses off his face and like crushed him in the floor with their fucking like high heel boot. And then someone else like walked on her boyfriend's Ferrari or something like that. And someone else had threatened like her daughter on the phone. But there were also women in there who'd been abused by their husbands in the same
And they group. Just couldn't take it anymore.
But in the same group as people who were like abusers, it was like a very weird thing.
Yeah.
I would think you'd separate. It was very weird. And so.
Yeah. But they're just like, oh, they're all chicks. So we'll just throw them in together.
Yeah. Right. And it was like. Yeah, I was like the asshole of that group too. It's all in the book. And then no, but I was one of the few chicks on the sweeping crew. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh yeah, definitely.
I showed up and I was just like, oh my God. Like, I mean, I'm from Beverly Hills. I went to like an all girls private uniform school and like, you know, was like really highly educated. And I was like, this is not.
Oh, so you were kind of like almost like a goody two shoes, huh?
A total goody two shoes, straight A's, all that stuff. So this is like the last thing my parents expected.
To happen, especially later on in life.
No, I was a total late bloomer. And so, so when I showed up at community labor, I was like, oh my God, like these people are criminals. Like I'm a Jewish American princess. And you know, it was like 40 like Hispanic dudes and me.
And you.
They're like, you know, what you here for, Weta? I'm here for a DUI. What you here for? And I was like, oh, I'm here for felony domestic violence with a deadly weapon. They were like, oh shit. So I was like, right. I was like the crazy white bitch. So nobody.
Right. The carry knives. So you used to do stand up. When did you start doing stand up?
I started doing stand up when I got sober around 39, and I did it through mm-hmm. my marriage until I relapsed and got arrested. And then I was in, trying to get sober. I had a nervous breakdown. I tried to kill myself. I was in treatment for 7 months. I was mm-hmm. in sober living for 2.5 years. And I was really focused on sort of trying to get my life together, going through the divorce and a criminal trial. And mm-hmm. although it's all great material, it wasn't really that funny at the time. And also there was a curfew at the sober living. And so I wasn't like, hey, sorry, I got to blow a curfew. Got to go do it 10 minutes at the store. You know what I mean?
Right.
So I took a break and I just never really went back. And
never went back.
Writing, and that's become sort of my whole life now, writing for magazines. And then I wrote a book, and now mm-hmm. we're shopping the book as a series, and I'm working on a second book and that kind of stuff. And so now like recovery has kind of become my whole thing. And mm-hmm. there aren't a lot of funny recovery writers, which is odd.
No, yeah.
Like, well, because a lot of times I feel like they memoirs
want, either. Yeah. Like they want to take
Kristen it Johnston serious. Is funny mm-hmm. and like, you know, that kind of stuff. But in general, you know, people don't, you know, they're depressing. But I was like, I don't know. For me, I needed to use my humor to get through it. Otherwise mm-hmm. I was just going to blow my brains out.
Yeah, no, it could definitely help. But I also think some of those people, like they don't want to glorify some of their, you know,
I was very careful not to glorify it at all. It was, but I also think that, you know, we have a real gallows humor about us, mm-hmm. which is, you know, funny is really dark, and
the general public may not understand.
You know, and also
today.
The story was very depressing. So, I mean, mm-hmm. if I didn't have some laughter in it, where people could kind of just take a break and have a breath and have a laugh, it was just going to be just too dark of a fucking story. It was just too sad. There was like too many suicide attempts and too much. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It was just you know, too many relapses. I was like, I gotta give some people a balance, or they're gonna just like fucking hang themselves from the shower spigot reading this. They're just gonna be like, oh god.
Yeah, you gotta.
I think you can write about addiction without in a way where you're being self-effacing. I don't, you know, I really dislike memoirs that are self-pitying. That's not my jam. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like I take full, even though it's not my fault that I'm a drug addict, it is my responsibility.
Yeah, I like that line. Yeah, because a lot of times, and that's the thing too, is that especially even in today's society and stuff, like they are always blaming the addicts, but they're never,
because it's a choice, because we really want to end up under a bridge losing everything. That's our dream.
It's like sucking dick for heroin. I've always wanted
to do that. God, who doesn't want to do that? Isn't what you dreamt of as a little girl?
I always wanted to marry my drug dealer. What are you talking about? Yeah, so when people think that it's basically a choice, it's not necessarily a choice, but I think
what people get confused about, and this is the thing, like, you know, was it a choice to pick up the first time and try it? Mm-hmm. Yes, but did I know I was going to be an addict? Of course not.
Yeah,
and there are plenty of people who are recreational users and they're not addicts because mm-hmm. why? They don't have the trauma or the biology that creates mm-hmm. that weird obsession and craving and where you can't stop. Mm-hmm. And so it's like, is it my choice now to pick up again now that I'm sober? Sure. Mm-hmm. Now I have choice again because I've stopped. I got the monster in a box. You know what I mean? I mean, at the very, 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 very bottom of my using, was it a choice to stop? I mean, I guess once mm-hmm. I lost everything, I mean, I mean, I had a sex addiction too. I mean, that felt really compulsive. If you've ever had a compulsive behavior, it doesn't really feel like there's much choice involved.
Yeah. It's just something that you feel like you need.
Yeah. You have to do it. Yeah. I think that, you know, with help, you can break that compulsive cycle, but it's not just like, it's a willpower thing, you know, or God or Jesus did it for me. Like, that's not my take on the whole thing.
Yeah.
But you know, drugs hijack your brain, your prefrontal cortex shuts down. It's, I mean, you know, all of that kind of stuff. So
it becomes dependent on it.
Powerful.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, I have a little, I actually have a necklace that has like, it's like the chemical compound for dopamine.
Oh, cool.
Which is cute. Cause like, yeah. Cause like I like cocaine has always been my favorite drug. So I got that little necklace. So anytime I feel like I need some dopamine, I play with the necklace. I mean,
you should read The Molecule of More by Daniel Lieberman.
Okay.
It's about dopamine and it's fucking fascinating. Yeah. And we actually, I have a podcast called Rehab Confidential and we mm-hmm. had him on and it's the most fascinating shit ever.
Yeah.
Because it drives everything. It talks about love and sex and how after 2 years with someone, how like that tingly, like, I want to fuck you so bad goes away. And then you have mm-hmm. to be willing to move into sort of like a companionate love. And most people go, well, I'm not in love with you anymore. It's like, well, that part never really lasts for most people. That's the dopamine. Yep. That's the druggy dopamine part. And mm-hmm. it talks about drug addiction. It talks about sex addiction. It talks about social media.
Oh, social media is a big one.
Oh,
yeah.
It's so addicting. Social media has got me by the fucking cojones right now. Yeah. Got me by the balls, man. It's terrible. Like, do people like it? Do more likes? More likes? Yeah. You know, that's why I can't go on Tinder or any of those dating apps. They're set up exactly like.
Oh, exactly like that.
I mean,
yeah.
I thought about this. I wrote this in my book and then they talk about it later. Like Tinder is set up like a slot machine, like ding, like with the fucking sound effects and mm-hmm. they're like, ding, you've got a match and you get like a shot of dopamine. Someone likes me. Like this might be my person and I'm gonna do. And it's like, I mean, mm-hmm. Tinder was like eBay for dick. I was like, oh my God, fucking help me. I had to stop. I can't do any of those dating apps. I'll just spend all day on that shit.
Yeah, I definitely, when anytime I've gone on the dating apps, I'll just like, I'll buy like the premium membership. So that way I could just scroll through all the people that liked me. I have all the notifications turned off on my phone. Like my phone is silent 24/7. I have like mom and like a couple of friends that like barely text me unless they need something.
you know?
Yeah.
Is that for your ADHD or is that just for
both?
The
no, like I definitely, especially
sort of component of it.
It both, especially during quarantine, like in the beginning, like because it shows you how much time it'd be like 8 hours a day on social media. I'd be like, what the fuck? And like you're embarrassed and you're just like, how did that even happen? How did I waste 8 fucking hours on social media? And not just like, I'll just going back and forth. And the thing is, it's like, I'll open up Twitter and then I'll close out Twitter and then I'll open up Instagram and then I'll close out Instagram thinking I'm going to go to the bathroom. And then I just open up Twitter again. And then I'm on the couch. I haven't even showered yet. I'm like, oh, we need to do something about that. Cause that is what the fuck. And also I'm like, I am too old to be on social media that long. Like I use it for work, you know, like it's.
Why is it for work too? I mean,
yeah. Like to promote stuff and shit. And
the problem now is platform is everything. It's everything to sell a book. It's everything mm-hmm. to sell anything. If you have a podcast and you mm-hmm. want sponsors, you need a platform. And that's the fucked up part about the whole thing.
Yeah. Is that like, it is actually has some very useful benefits.
Yeah,
like a lot of drugs.
Exactly. Popularity can actually equal money.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's all in moderation. I just have a timer on it. I'm allowed like 2 hours. And then once quarantine or whatever is over, it's like an hour a day, as long as I post my show. Sometimes, I mean, I don't do it all of the time because I'm addicted, obviously, but yeah, for the most part, it's definitely just like, it's fine. Like, I don't care. I can't care. Like I'm actually shadow banned on Instagram and Facebook for tweeting out a bunch of stuff about how I think. I think that they're sexist and hypocrites because men are allowed to be topless on Facebook and Instagram, but women can't be. Like I have a bunch of dudes who follow me that just have like their nipple as their profile picture, but it's okay because they're men.
Right.
But if women show a little bit of nipple or even like a little bit of butt crack, like their accounts are getting shut down and whatever. So I tweet them every once in a while.
I have a lot of sex educator friends that are just like so over it all.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they're trying to like disseminate information. You know what I mean? About stuff. And they're getting fucking shut down. It's mm-hmm. like,
Like just basic sexual health stuff. And it's just
that kind of stuff. It's
It's just like, you guys are over sexualizing the female form and completely, I'm trying to like word it all different ways just to make them feel like assholes. And apparently it either worked to the point where at least one person that works there. Yeah. When you Google my name, my profiles, Instagram and Facebook, I'm verified on Facebook. They refuse to verify me on Instagram. And I'm like, fuck you. I'm like, I'm still going to tweet about you. I don't give a fuck. Fucking little old me got you all wrangled up.
Oh my God, it's hilarious.
But yeah, social media is, but that's also a thing where it's like, where it's that addiction where I'm like, I have a Wikipedia page. I should be verified everywhere. You get in that mindset. You really fucking do. And it's like, I don't even think I'm that fucking cool. You know what I mean? Like, I'm
All comparative and it's like, you're comparing yourself with other people and blah, blah. And it's you know, well, that person's an idiot. Why are they verified? Like my
Or how come that tweet got so many likes and mine didn't? I'm funnier than that person.
It's such a mind fuck. It's just you can't. Like, I got in a Twitter fight with someone just this morning. Just like, it got so, it was even before 10 a.m. and I'm like fighting with someone on Twitter. And I was like, okay.
Maybe take a break. Like, I try to make sure.
Like, in general, I usually, because I posted something about the sponsor for our podcast, and he wrote something, and I guess he felt attacked by my response, which I thought my response was pretty chill, but I mean, I don't think he knows what feeling attacked by me really feels like. Maybe you should talk to my ex-husband.
Well, there's no context on the internet either. People.
Well, yeah, there's no context. And was it semiotics? That's like the same thing with texting. You can't read tone. Mm-hmm. So then things that are jokes come off as really harsh or
Or you're just being a cunt or so. Yeah.
I read it. So I was like, called my sponsor and I was like, did I do something wrong? And I like went off on this tirade and he hung up on me. I go, did you hang up on me? He goes, yeah, because you wouldn't shut up. I've heard enough. And I was like, wow.
Okay. Yeah, the internet, it's definitely breeding some weird.
I don't
want to
watch Social Dilemma. Have you seen Social Dilemma? I'm scared.
Oh yeah, no.
Oh,
yeah,
I'm scared. Watch it. I'm scared.
It's very educational.
I want to shut everything down. I don't want to do that. I can't. I mean, I remember when my book got published, my agent was, I wasn't even on Instagram because I was like, I don't like taking pictures of myself and they were like, you need an Instagram for your book. And I was like, and the publisher was like, you have to do that, dude. And I was like,
and you love it now.
You know, I know. Right? Thanks for turning me out, bitch.
All right. Thanks for giving me another
fix. Just a tip.
Just try a taste, baby.
I'll spot you this bag, man.
Of this likes. I try to stay off of social media, like, cause I'll have some like scheduled tweets or whatever, cause you could do that on certain platforms, but I try to stay off. Until like, I at least walk my dog and, you know, I get up, like make my bed, whatever, brush my teeth and shit, like feed my dog. I'll meditate. I'll be like, once I walk my dog, if I can make it to where I can work out before I look, that's a good day.
Wow. I'm so impressed.
That's a good day. But yeah, normally, because I also look at the times that most people are on and it's like, oh, it's like between 11 and like one.
Right,
and I'm like,
you wanna post.
And I'm like, that's my workout time. And that's what happens is that I'll sit on Twitter and be like, oh, I missed my workout. I guess I can't work out. So funny. Oh God. That's great. Okay. let me ask. So do you have, any advice that was given to you by someone that was good that you would give to somebody else that was using that like wants to get clean?
I would say that it's never too late. And no matter how many times you've relapsed or fallen down, that doesn't mean you can't get it.
Yeah.
Because for me, I relapsed a lot. And
you said seven times, right?
No, that's seven rehabs. I've relapsed way more.
Yeah, seven rehabs.
So I was like, I mean, I started to think I'm going to die a drug addict. Like, I'm just not someone who can get sober. And it's just not possible. And it caused a lot of shame. And I think that there's a lot of shame attached to relapsing. And I think that it's hard to get sober. It's hard to rewire your brain. It's hard to stop something you're addicted to, be it love or sex or shopping or gambling or, you know, Instagram likes or Coke or whatever. Yeah, it's really hard and it takes work, and it's okay to fall down and get back. The key is to not die.
Yeah.
You want to not die and like keep trying. Mm-hmm. And I would say, you know, if you decide to go into a 12-step program, like, you know, don't get into the comparison trap of like time and the hierarchy, like fuck that and fuck what people think. Like, mm-hmm. you know, it's a bunch of loadies. Do you really give a shit? I mean, 12 steps saved my life, no joke, you know, and I've moved a little bit away from it because I find a little bit fundamentalist in some ways. I'm a Jew and it's like a little bit Christian-y.
Some of the
basic stuff like meditation is good and helping people is good and fucking taking, you know, doing a, making amends is great and mm-hmm. doing an inventory is great and seeing where you're an asshole and all that kind of stuff. Like I need a moral compass. I need a map for how to behave like a human being because otherwise I'll be an asshole.
Yeah.
So it's like, but I would say that it's like, don't worry about what people think. Just keep trying. And if that doesn't work for you and that doesn't click for you, there's a zillion other recovery programs. A lot of people age out of it. They just stop. Mm-hmm. Something happens, they get pregnant and they just stop. You know, not everyone needs, you know,
the program
or a refuge recovery or smart recovery or rehab or mm-hmm. sober living for 2.5 years or whatever. Do you know what mm-hmm. I mean? Many people just spontaneously just shift out of it. A lot of people gets worse and worse and worse and worse. It depends, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I would say that, you know, two things. One is I learned that the urges pass. It took me 25 years to realize like the urge is going to pass whether I do this thing or not,
mm-hmm.
whether I use or smoke or call that guy or get on, you know, that urge will pass, you know, jack mm-hmm. off, take a bath, watch mm-hmm. a program, take a walk, like, mm-hmm. and then it passes. I'm not saying it won't come back, but you got through that urge and it's like the urge, cause it feels when the urge hits you, you're like, I gotta do it. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? But you don't. Mm-hmm. It's just really uncomfortable and the feelings aren't going to kill you. And it took me a really long time to realize urges pass whether you use or not. Mm-hmm. But if you use, then you're on a fucking bender and you're fucked.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? If you have addiction. And the other thing I learned too is like that I'm not my thoughts and my feelings. You know, like that's, I think what you've learned from meditation is that there's a center of yourself separate from your thoughts and your feelings. You can see your thoughts and your feelings going by like leaves on a river and go, oh, that's mm-hmm. interesting. And mm-hmm. be detached from it instead of every thought and every feeling is all encompassing and takes you on some weird emotional ride that takes you to a place of action. You're just kind of like, oh, shrugging it off, you know, mm-hmm. oh, taxes. Oh, my ex. Oh, da da. Like, okay.
Yeah.
You know, you have 50,000 thoughts a day. Pick which ones you pay attention to, because for me, my thoughts drove my behavior for my entire mm-hmm. life and not in a good way.
Mm-hmm.
I had to feel good all the time. You're not gonna feel good all the time. It's life, man.
Yeah.
Not about, you know, being happy all the time. Like, you know, as addicts, we don't like to feel uncomfortable, unhappy. We want to fucking feel good all the fucking time mm-hmm. or numb. And we want it yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
We're not patient and we don't like discomfort. We're babies.
Yeah.
That's my, you know, and so I've realized my feelings won't kill me. It doesn't matter how I feel. It matters what I do.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really that the action changes my feelings. And that's what I learned. I had a sponsor and he was just like, you don't have to be a good person. You just have to act like one. No one knows the fucking difference. And I was like, well, that doesn't seem very truthful. But he's right. No mm-hmm. one's judging you on your intentions. They're judging you on your actions.
Your actions. Yeah.
Who can, you know, you can't control your thoughts or your feelings. All mm-hmm. you can control are your actions.
That's what you
do. So, yeah. So I might want to go fucking vape every day, all day, but I'm not,
mm-hmm.
you know, I might want to get on Tinder and fucking, you know, be like, have you ever ripped through a cougar? You know, but I'm not going to, you know what I mean? Or whatever, you know, because that's all that matters. And like you said, like, even with working out, like who feels like working out? No one ever. I'm never like, I can't wait to work out. I mean, there are freakos that are like that, but that's not me.
No.
But
I just like the way my butt looks. That's literally the only reason why I do it.
Right, vanity, of course. Yeah. Hi. Right. So it's like, do I want the results and do I feel better after?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah, of course.
Meditation. Do I like the results and do I feel better after? Yes, so action changes your feelings. So that's what I would say is, you know, don't listen to your feelings and, you know, that you can get it. Anyone can get it.
anyone could get clean. Well, that's great.
I really believe that. I mean,
yeah.
And also I think that, you know, if you've got like co-occurring, mental illness, you definitely need to get that treated. I mean, it's impossible to stay clean if you're like an unmedicated bipolar or schizophrenic or.
Yeah. Self-medicating, which my dad liked to do that a lot.
You got to fucking get that shit under control because it's hard enough to stay sober, let alone with like gnarly depression or mood swings.
Yeah, especially bipolar. My dad, he used to, when he was on meds, he was great. But when he was off meds, like when he was in his depressive phase, that's when he did a lot of coke to try to like build him up. And, and then when he was in his manic phase, that's when he would like shoot up heroin. And like, he was very excited that everything was in pill form, that they had oxys and Adderall. He was very excited. He's like, because I ain't got the veins, Alia. And I'm like, I'm weird. I used to pull them out of your arm, Dad. But he's definitely one of those. I haven't spoken to him in a while, but he's one of those lifelong kind of users. He definitely justifies.
He's not clean?
Not that I know. The last time I talked to him was honestly the day that my brother died, 2009, because he was on one of his benders and he was off of his meds and he wasn't with his wife. He was with a new girl that he said was going to be his wife. And he tried to blame me for my brother, his son's death. And then he could put the woman on the phone and she said that I was just jealous that that he was starting a new family. And I just said, I'm like, oh, tell me more about this new family. Oh, that's adorable. Really? Wow. I'm like, you've known him for 6 hours, sweetheart.
And I want to be clear. Like, I am not against drugs. I fucking love drugs. And if I can fucking do drugs all day, every day, and like be functional and have a life and not like wear a helmet and like drive a car and like not ruin all my relationships or be arrested for trying to stab people, I totally would do it.
Yeah.
Like, I fucking love it. And if you're a drug user and you can maintain your life, like great. Like drug users are people too. And you have I'm totally for legalization of everything because I think that the big thing that's killing people is unsafe supply. As a Jew, I don't really understand why you would, you know, put fentanyl and heroin and kill off your fucking customer base as a Jew, as I don't really.
Yeah. Like that's not financially.
You know, yeah. It doesn't make sense. I mean, there's so many fucking people, but it's like, I am all for like, if you can use drugs safely and fucking like have a life and it's not impeding your life, or if you choose to be a homeless drug addict, like that's your choice. Everyone has the right to self-determine.
Yeah.
You know, but I was like suicidal and shit was not, I couldn't keep anything together. Like I'm barely functional now at 8 years. I'm still like, wait, what?
Yeah.
I can't cook, but I can cook up dope. Is that what you want for dinner? You know, I mean, I'm really like still like have my friends are raising me. I'm like, you know, I spent 20 years, you know, in psych wards and institutions or being taken care of by people because I'm crazy, don't you know? And I'm a drug addict and I'm broken. And so everyone took care of me and I was like, I had everyone on a fucking string.
Yeah.
Until they got over my shit. I mean, my dad went to Al-Anon one time and I called him trying to manipulate him for drugs or money for drugs.
Yeah.
Because you used to be able to ruin my life. Now you can't even ruin my lunch. Fuck. And that's when I knew the gig was up. You know, people called me out and they weren't going to let me manipulate them anymore when there was like, we're like, we're tired of you at the bottom of the well, dude. Like, we don't have money for you. We're tired of bailing you out. This has been going on for a long. We're drained emotionally and financially. Like, call me with good news or don't call me, honey.
Yeah.
Like, when everyone kind of did that to me, but in a loving way, but I love you and I will help you in any way I can. And I believe in you, you know, not in a harsh way.
Yeah.
I fucking,
but it was definitely one of those like cut off kind of things.
Yeah. Like a boundary way where they were just like, hey, man, I love you and I believe you can do this, but like, I'm over your shit.
Your shit. Yeah.
Yeah. And then I got it. I mean, I'd had it before, but for me, it was about growing up. You know, I didn't want to grow up. I didn't want to take responsibility. And it's ironic.
I still don't want to grow up. I'm 40.
No, I don't either. I know, but it's like, you know,
I think adults need adults, to be honest. I think we need another adult. I still don't know how to fucking do my tax. I'm like, I don't
know. I know. Well, that's why I have all my friends help me with everything. I don't know how to do anything. Yeah, and that's kind of, you know, and I also am just really developmentally delayed. And I, but I think what I realized too, is like, it's not just me. It's like, no one, everyone's faking everything. No one knows how to do fucking anything.
Yeah.
And that's okay. We're just all pretending. That's why you ask for help.
Yeah. That's all being like an adult is kind of, is just acting like you know what you're doing because you're supposed to. Oh God,
yeah.
Totally. Like balancing a checkbook. I'm like, well, no, I know how to make an ashtray. I'm like, I know how to make an ashtray out of plastic. That's what I learned in high school. No, I still don't either. I don't even I don't know.
I don't either. My friend was trying to explain it to me with boxes of rice. She was like, this is your checking and this is your savings. And I was like, I'm getting flooded. I was like, I can't, you know what I mean? It's like, yeah, I mean, but like you, like I can make a fucking crack bong out of a Mountain Dew bottle with gum and a fucking straw.
Yeah, instantly.
I could rock you up crack in a microwave with some baking soda if you want that.
I could cook up some ketamine. Yeah,
I can hit your jugular.
Ooh, yeah, that's a good
different skill sets. No shame.
No shame. Like I always said, like the skill sets, especially some of the stuff that my father taught me, like I would be great in apocalypse, like abso-fucking-lutely. Like I know how to like defend myself. I know how to make weapons out of weird shit. I know how
was
to
he
break.
In prison?
Yeah. Yeah. He was in prison for a while. He was also like when he was younger, him and my uncle used to steal cars for the mob. And then like my uncle was in a biker gang and like he was actually a deputy sheriff in Texas. Yeah, I'm trying to work out this joke about how my dad may be a serial killer, actually. So that's taken, and it's really hard to make that kind of funny. So we're working on that.
There are a couple things that I found hard to make funny and stand up. Like suicide was hard.
Yeah.
You know.
My buddy Drew Michaels, he has a suicide bit, and like sometimes it will hit really hard and other times he's just like, see, these types of jokes are meant for people who've actually gone through it, because you guys never try to kill yourself, so you don't think that's funny, but the people who have tried to kill themselves,
that's so true.
Hilarious.
That's so true. That's really true, actually.
Yeah. So and Sherrod Smalls, he has the other one. He's like, you gotta know stuff or been through stuff to get stuff.
Totally. That's so
like
true.
you're not gonna understand, weirdly enough,
you know, like the A crowd is the fucking best crowd ever because they're so fucking dark. Everyone's been in psych ward, everyone's tried to kill themselves, everyone's had a restraining order against them, everyone's fucking been an IV drug user, everyone's had an abscess, you know, everyone's tried to stab somebody, you know what I mean? Like nothing is shocking, everything is funny, you know.
Yeah Where it's that, and it's healing, like that humor where you can do that means that you've healed from it, and when people can't laugh at that, it's like, oh, you haven't healed, and that's your responsibility, not my responsibility.
It's not that we don't take it seriously or think it's horrible, but it's also like, you know, it's weird, like we're the opposite. Like when people say like something good happening in their lives, like I'm having a baby or I got my book published, you know, everyone cries. And when you say something like horrible, we all laugh. Like we're just it's all upside down. You know, we're just
comedy
different.
And tragedy. You know, it's a vicious circle. It is very vicious. Yeah. So where can people find you, like online on your social media, since you're on there?
Oh God. Okay, can I check right now? I'm like Amy Dresner, Dresner, Amydresner, everywhere. Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. Yeah.
The main ones.
Rehab Confidential. My book is called My Fair Junkie. It came out in 2017. You can mostly buy it on Amazon. It's been out for a while. But yeah.
That's good. And then you're shopping around a show that's based off of the book you said. So that's exciting.
It's really exciting.
Yay. All right. Well, thank you so much for coming on. It was fucking amazing talk with you. This was super fun. As everyone knows, you can find this show. Wherever the fuck you're listening to it, Amazon, iTunes. I used to have a list of everything and I just gave up on that because people are going to listen to it wherever the fuck they're listening to it. Just rate and subscribe and join the Patreon if you guys want some exclusive and premiere content. I also do Weekly vlogs. That's, yeah, I'm a vlogger now.
Oh God.
Yeah, only on Patreon.
I'm trying not to hold that against you. Okay.
Thank you. And for like,
no, 10 I should minutes. Do that, but I just can't. I'm just like, I don't know, like what?
I'm on my fourth one. It's starting to get easier.
I'm so sick of myself.
Yeah. Yeah. And then I have to like look at the camera talking to myself. Like I'm talking to other people.
Yeah, right.
So yeah, I've already told them I'm like, I hate the vlogs, but they like them. So I do them.
Are you on TikTok?
I fucking hate myself. Yeah, of course I'm. It took me all of quarantine. Like I was actually tweeting and be like, I haven't gone on Instagram live or on TikTok. What do I win? And then my girl's like, bitch, get on TikTok. And then I was on TikTok. I already got like suspended for like a bunch
of
shit.
You're the worst. You're always in trouble. You're like my co-host is in Facebook jail every other week. I get a fucking text all the time. It's like, oops.
My girl, like, I don't even do anything.
Yeah, I'm like, are you in Facebook jail again? He's like, yeah.
I've only been in Facebook jail once and they still have me shadow banned. Instagram, never. Yeah.
Oh, they just tried to boost a post that had a bad word in it. It was like just a normal post. And I was like, I'll just boost this on my Amy Dresner official page. Didn't even think about it. And they have blocked me from ever boosting again. I'm like, okay, you don't want my money? From any account, then fuck you.
I mean? I can't promote shit, paid stuff on Twitter. Instagram, I could still do. Facebook, it's like, they'll tell me which ones I can and which ones I can't.
One time I used one bad word. I'm like, I'm sorry, it was an accident. I just was like, they were like, you want to boost it? And I was like, sure, you know?
Yeah.
And now, like, you can't let that go.
No. And honestly, it doesn't seem to really work.
It doesn't. I've heard it doesn't do shit.
They're just taking your money.
I've seen all my friends like with their promoted posts. I'm like, how's that doing?
Yeah. I'm like, I already follow you. Why? Anytime I see one by my friends, I'm like, I already follow you. Like, this should be going to a different audience.
I'm so dead. Oh, God. What are your TikToks like?
Which ones did I get in trouble for? Oh, I got in trouble for calling a bunch of dudes with, like, they made this video about like 4-inch dicks or something like that. Like 4 inches is enough. And like the dude has like t-shirts and dead serious.
Sorry.
And
was that sizest? I don't know.
Yeah, I'm absolutely take your 4 inches like, and four fucking inches, kill yourself. No. Like, what the fuck are you talking about?
Kill yourself.
Like, hey, like you shouldn't be reproducing. That's why your dick is small, because you're not supposed to reproduce. It's not supposed to reach anything. You're too small for that. But I had said, and I said it, I'm just like, they just got little peckers and they just need to deal with it. And I don't know why I use the Southern accent. I got suspended for that one. But there's like a couple where I'm like talking to myself, like quarantine style, like in my apartment.
Right.
And yeah, no, they're dumb. We need like comedy back. I'm like, cause there's so many comics right now that are on TikTok. I'm like, we just need a stage. The whole reason why we're on TikTok is because we don't have a stage. Just give us a fucking stage. I don't care if it's in the middle of the fucking ocean.
Can, like, kind of dance. It's like fucking, it's a bazillion.
I'm like, I'm too old to be doing like dance stuff.
No,
like
I'm a Jew. You know, I have no rhythm. I'm not gonna, you know. Everyone's like, go on TikTok. I'm like, I just can't.
I did some of the lip syncing ones or whatever. And then someone's like, that's untalented. I'm like, that's actually really fucking hard.
I know. It is really hard, right? I know.
I was like, I'm gonna like give him, although like there's this one comic who got like super famous for like mimicking Trump or whatever.
Oh, Sarah, I know. Remember, she's amazing. That was amazing.
No, she was really good at it, but I'm just like, the bitch got famous for lip syncing. I'm like, Millie Vanilli should be pissed off right now. You know what I mean? Like, if anyone should be real,
she got a show and everything.
Like a Netflix.
A bit of a one trick pony, but okay.
Yeah, I'm like, hey, girl, like, get it while you can.
I mean, I don't know. Is she gonna do Biden now? I don't know.
I have no idea. I've never heard her stand up or any. I've never even seen. I guess she lives in New York.
That's gonna be a hard transition, I would think.
Yeah, something like that, especially
Vanilli, right? Yeah, one of those guys is dead.
Yeah.
They were both like, I think, cokeheads, or at least one of them was.
They kind of, the hair, I don't know, that like in that time, like the long hair, like a black dude with long hair like that, like he's doing coke, right? I'm going to get arrested for that. cancel me. You can't cancel me. I've sucked too many dicks to be canceled. I already canceled myself.
Didn't you used to work in porn or something?
Yeah, I was in porn for 4 years.
Fucking awesome. I have a friend who works in porn and she's the fucking coolest, man.
Yeah, no, we're actually, and I noticed that like porn stars are actually way more normal than most comedians. That.
Oh, I believe it. I've dated and fucked enough comedians. They're dark and broken people.
Yeah, they really are. And I'm like, oh, this is why I feel at home though. All right, you guys. Thanks for tuning in. I'll see you later.